And joining us now on Hot Copy, it's an honor to have him here. The day after he gave his privilege speech and said goodbye, we have with us Senate Minority Leader Franklin Drilon. Senator Drilon, good morning to you, sir.
Good morning, Karen, and thank you for having me again. Probably the last time?
Well, hopefully not the last time. But let me say first, that was quite an emotional environment in the Senate yesterday. Did you expect that? Colleagues tearing up. I saw photos and videos of your colleagues hugging you. Even the men were tearing.
Well, I didn't expect it, particularly from Senator Bato de la Rosa.
Yeah.
You know, Bato is identified with the administration, with President Duterte, and for him to accord me that kind of affection and respect is something that I will treasure. Superlatives in his commendation for what I have done, particularly on the new senators. So I did not expect the emotion that went with the after the speeches, much less that kind of affection showed by a guy who was a former chief of the PNP, Bato de la Rosa, who is known for his very very firm stance on various issues. Salamat sa ating magsama, lalo na po kay Senator Ronald de la Rosa.
All right. Now, you've been a senator for 24 years, but you've been a Senate president four times. You actually won a Senate seat in the 1990s. In all these years, let's start first with looking back. What are the most important lessons that you've learned in these 24 years?
First, I learned that getting elected did not make me senator. I had to learn how I want to work hard, study hard, to be worthy of the title. Mm-hmm. You know, I have learned in the Senate that respect begets respect. Mm-hmm. That you can never impose respect from your colleagues. You have to earn it. And there is no way of gaining the respect of my peers and the public in general, but to show to them that you are diligent, you study, and you come to the session hall prepared. You know, Karen, what I have learned in the 24 years that I have been there is that legislation is the art of the possible. Mm-hmm. And you have to build a consensus in a deliberative, the democratic body like the Senate, where there are 24 senators, each with their own mandate, mm-hmm. and would carry the voice of those who voted for them. So mm-hmm. you must respect their views if you are the Senate president, and you must be able to build a consensus. Mm-hmm. It cannot be a winner-take-all.
Yeah.
It cannot be a winner-take-all. And I have learned that over the 24 years. Mm-hmm. And as minority leader, I have led the chamber in many instances in trying to come up with a compromise on various issues. Of course, if there are issues where you know the views are so deep and divergent, then you come to a vote. But mm-hmm. those are more the exceptions than the rule. Oftentimes, we try to have a consensus, and that is the very crucial role of a Senate president. Otherwise, you can never have the work done.
Yeah. Now, Senator, in your speech yesterday, you mentioned how it was like, you know, interpolating and debating with the greats from the likes of Kit Tata, Jefisto Gingona, Juan Ponce Enrile. How would you describe then and now?
Well, yes, I learned the ropes and had to go under the microscope with the likes of Senator Enrile, Natalie Gonzalez, and all those guys who preceded us. And it was a learning process. I had to study. I had to listen. Mm-hmm. I was quiet for the first few months, trying to learn the traditions of the institution of democracy called the Senate. And that was how I was able to get into the group. So that's it. Well, in the present Senate, my colleagues are open to debate. Nobody has told me to stop asking questions. Senate President Soto has adhered and has adhered to the no cloture rule in our debates, meaning that you can't stop anyone from asking questions. And the incoming Senate President, Big Zubiri, as a majority leader, has improved his skills on trying to build a consensus. And that's why I think he's fit to become the Senate President, apart from his knowledge of various policy issues that confront our country.
Uh-oh. Senator Drilon, my sources tell me in the Senate that you're known for actually reading a lot of research materials, the bills that are sent to you. You read them in great detail. What would you say of the new senators, some coming from different fields, who have won out of their sheer popularity and may not have done, or they're not studying as much, not doing enough research? Anong masasabi niyo po doon?
At kailangan po mag-aral sila because they are now senators, as I have said earlier, I was getting elected to the Senate. Does that make one a senator? You must earn the respect of your peers first and the public second. There is nothing wrong with study, with getting advice from experts in the field, because in the Senate you get confronted with issues in various fields, and therefore to be able to participate and contribute your share in policy making, you must have certain knowledge of what is the issue at hand. In my case, having been having been in the executive branch for 9 years, and
being Secretary of Justice.
Yes, Department Secretary of Labor, Secretary of Justice, and Executive Secretary, I could claim that I had a working knowledge of almost every aspect of governance in our country. And therefore, when laws come up for policy debates, I brush up on my past experience and participate in the crafting and molding of a policy. To my younger, to those who are incoming, there is no substitute for studying and learning. Learning, as we know, is a never-ending process. Even at my age, 76, I continue to read. I continue to learn new things.
Very quickly, lang, Senator. What advice would you give Senator Robin Padilla, who has taken on the committee chairmanship of constitutional amendments? What advice would you give him?
I join the incoming Senate President Zubiri when he said that mag-aral ka ng mabuti. That is a very clear advice that I join the incoming Senate President as our message to Senator elect Robin Padilla. You know, the committee that he chose to head, Committee on Constitutional Amendments and Revision of Codes and Laws. Mm-hmm. And this requires, Senator Zubiri said, this requires legal knowledge. And not only legal knowledge, you must have had exposure to the Constitution and the remember, it says revision of codes and laws. And the codes there would refer to major laws like the civil code, the revised penal code, the corporation code, all the codified laws. And it's not easy, not easy to do that. I don't claim to know all of those, but certainly to a neophyte senator who have had no exposure to this subject, he needs a lot of schooling. He needs, in fairness to the public, who expects him to come up with policies insofar as not only the process of amending the Constitution, but the substance of the amendment. You must be able to debate with your colleagues so that you can come up with a most reasonable policy. That's what my advice.
So it's important also that he gets a good team, right? Now, moving forward, what would you consider as the highlight of your 24-year career in the Senate?
Well, I would consider as my being able to occupy the post of Senate President for the longest time after second only to the late Senate President Eulogio Rodriguez. I was a Senate President for 8 years and 7 months, elected to the post by my peers four times.
Specific moments in time.
Yeah.
I remember you were Senate President when the I accuse speech of former Senator Teofisto Gingona happened. And let's talk about that quick moment, just quickly.
Yes, right. I was Senate President when Tito Gingona delivered the I accuse speech in 2000 that led to the impeachment of then President Estrada. Yeah, I had the unique experience of sitting down as a senator judge twice, one for Senate President, for President Estrada, the second one for Chief Justice Corona. I was also the Senate President in a divided Senate, the 12th Congress from 2001 to 2004, when there was even a rough session where the opposition and senators, including now the Senate President Vicente Soto, hosted me and had a rough session. We had to do all kinds of maneuvers in order to maintain the Senate. In 2004, I was the Senate President when we had the longest canvas of the presidential election, the proclamation took place barely 10 days before the expiry or before the June 30 deadline. And I tell you, Karen, during that time, because of so many allegations of misconduct of the election, of cheating, while I was canvassing, I get so many text messages saying, Senator Rilon, don't proclaim anyone. Assume the presidency while we are threshing out who really...
Is that right? Won.
Yes, I was receiving... Not only was I receiving those messages, I was also receiving threats on the other side, saying, threatening me with bodily harm if I do not proceed with the proclamation. And that is why it took us so long after the election in 2004. It took me until the middle of June before could proclaim. So, now also, the Hilo Garcia controversy was during my time. And most importantly, we challenged President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo in the Supreme Court when he issued that EO 464 in 2005, which prevented cabinet members from appearing in the Senate.
But Senator Drilon, all of this I mean, clearly you've been a front seat witness to history. You've even been a part of it, a player in it. Everything you've mentioned, how do you believe, looking back, has that changed you as a lawmaker, as a person, as a man, even in terms of your temperament, your character?
Well, firstly, you must have the strength to go through all of these difficulties. It's not easy.
Yeah.
It takes toll on your health. But let me say that the strength of having a good family behind you, united family behind you, gives you a lot of strength so that you just concentrate on what the issues that you must
face. What was the lowest period? What was the lowest period in your Senate life? Would you remember a period where you must have been either really depressed, thought of quitting, didn't know what to do?
Well, I didn't think of quitting, but you talk about what the most difficult portion was when I had to face, as Senate President, the Blue Ribbon Committee, because I was charged with having made money out of the project in Iloilo City by some blogger. Mm-hmm. And the chairman of the Blue Ribbon Committee at that time, for his own reasons, and politics is part of it, I'm sure, summoned me, a Senate President, to the Blue Ribbon hearing. Mm-hmm. And I, with confidence, I faced the Blue Ribbon Committee hearing as Senate President. That has never happened before.
But you found that quite humbling also, right?
Yeah. I found that quite humbling when I had to respond to questions from my peers in a committee hearing. But I stood my ground. I knew I committed no wrong. And it was an experience that I will not forget.
Okay. Do you have any regrets? I mean, clearly later we'll talk about the laws that are now in place because of your sponsorship and authorship. But do you have any regrets?
Well, I do not have any major regrets. My life in the Senate has been very fruitful, challenging, and I'm proud to say that I have participated in some major events in our history.
Clearly, there are several laws that you will leave as a legacy. And I'd like to mention some of the highlights of your career: the Public Service Act, the Retail Trade Liberalization Act, the Revised Corporation Code, the Syntax Reform Law, which is actually now responsible for getting more funding into the coffers of government, the Dual Citizenship Law, the GOCC Government Act of 2011. But that's just a few, really,
yes,
in 24 years. Yes. Among all the laws, right, that have been enacted with your authorship, sponsorship, participation, what do you believe is the most important for you personally? You feel most proud of that you did this?
Well, firstly, you know, I was the one who, among the first laws I passed in 1995, was the Dual Citizenship Act. Mm-hmm. That law, which allowed our former Filipino citizens who lost their citizenship because of naturalization in another country, they were allowed to maintain their Filipino citizenship. To me, that is a significant contribution that I made.
Because it's life-changing for the lives of people, lives of Filipino. May epekto sa buhay.
Yes, may epekto sa buhay. At yung many of the of our citizens who were deprived of the opportunities in our country could again exercise that. The second most significant laws that I passed are my having led the chamber in passing the original sin tax law, which revised the whole tax structure in the tobacco industry, and a complete departure from where it was before we passed the sin tax law. And finally in the recent times by having authored and pushed for the liberalization of our very restrictive economic environment. The Public Service Act, the Retail Trade Liberalization Act, and in fact, Karen, even if I was in the opposition, I am honored by having been recognized by the economic managers for the effort that I have placed in helping the administration pursue its liberalization of our very restrictive laws, which has resulted in a not so favorable investment climate.
Okay, I'm curious, just offhand though, and because you are leaving, you can speak candidly, which Congress was the hardest for you under what presidency? For you to work with, ha? Yung natatandaan mo noon, mahirap to.
Well, because of the events, you know, the most difficult period was during the time of President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, because there were so many policies that had to be reshaped during her time. There were so many events that shaped her presidency. Law Garcia is one of the most prominent. And of course, the impeachment of President Estrada was one of also the most difficult events that I had to confront with. And it was not easy. There were competing forces on both sides, and you had to be firm in your convictions and be able to defend where you stand at that time. Uh-oh.
Now, what about the time of President Duterte? You were my Senate Minority Leader, so you clearly wore a different hat. But we've also seen the weakening of the opposition during the last 6 years. How would you describe being Senate Minority Floor Leader and being a legislator under President Duterte's time?
Difficult, challenging, but worthy. Policies, in my view, were consistent with public interest. I supported the administration. But one major area where I have major disagreements with the administration was in the area of rule of law. I think this administration weakened an important pillar and basic tenet of our democratic system, and that is the rule of law. The extrajudicial killings, over 6,000 admitted by the PNP, was frustrating to me because you could not do anything in order to uphold the rule of law in our country, which was being trampled upon by this administration.
Now, senators are said to be, you call it you have 24 republics. Senators are expected to be independent-minded. But frankly, were you disappointed with your colleagues that none of them, or most of them didn't really, for example, speak up against Senator Laila de Lima's incarceration? Certain issues that you feel they should have become more vocal and had the courage to speak up?
Well, this is all I can say. In our work in the Senate, the matter of being affiliated with the administration is not the first consideration. When we talk about how the laws are crafted and what policies to adopt, I can assure you that in many instances, each senator exercised independence of judgment. Now, of course, in the political scene is different. My colleagues, in view of their political affiliation, stood by the administration. And that's the reality we face. Each would have his own belief. Each would have his own political leanings. And that's how it works. And unfortunately, I expected really more support from my colleagues. For example, just to cite a specific example, Senator Lacson and I crafted a resolution asking the PNP and the court to allow Senator De Riva to participate in our committee and in our sessions, videotape, not physical presence.
Like Zoom.
Like Zoom, which we have been doing by doing because of the pandemic. It would we filed the resolution asking all the majority the Senate to pass the resolution asking and putting behind the effort to allow Senator De Riva to participate in our deliberations, put the weight of the Senate behind that concept. We didn't get the majority. Yeah. You know, I was disappointed with that, and I was frustrated with that. It was a bipartisan resolution. Senator Lacson, a leader of the coalition in this majority coalition, the Senate, and I, as my minority leader, joined and tried to have that resolution passed. It did not. But on the other hand, there was a majority and minority coalition when we questioned the exercise of the powers of the president insofar as termination of treaties without the participation of the senators, particularly in the Visiting Forces Agreement, there was a bipartisan support. So well, this is how it works in a democracy. We have divergent views, we try to, but it worked.
Just very quickly on this, since you shared about your disappointment yesterday, you also have outgoing Senator Richard Gordon, who shared his disappointment that his fellow senators didn't sign the Farmley Committee report. And what do you make of that?
Well, you know, we are a deliberative body.
Yeah.
Each of the 24 senators would have his own views. If they the point of contention was the finding that President Duterte committed an impeachable offense, and that is what where the line was drawn. And you know, so the Senator Gordon report did not get the support of the majority. But mind you, Karen, not everything is thrown to waste there. Number one, in the next Congress, a law can be passed abolishing the PSDBM and the PITC because these were two vehicles used to commit a massive corruption, one of the biggest corruption deals I have seen in my career. The whole corruption in PSDBM started when the Secretary of Health Duque passed on $42 billion without any
documentation. You were the one who exposed the transfer of the funds. I think the public should remember that you found the transfer.
I did expose that as being contrary to law. You cannot. You know, you cannot treat this as your private funds and let somebody else spend what the Congress authorized you to spend. And that is, even if the committee report was not, did not get majority support, this is a valid finding exposed to public scrutiny and which the next president, Senate president, and Congress should look at closely. I have full confidence Senator Migzubiri, that he will lead his chamber in pursuing the results of the investigation. And there is nothing that will prevent the 19th Congress from again taking up the report. A resolution can be filed by any of the senators asking that the Blue Ribbon investigate. The next Blue Ribbon can adopt all the findings in the present Congress of the Blue Ribbon and present a new report for adoption.
Now, what you are leaving the Senate with? You're leaving the Senate with more families together. Meron ka nang there? I think meron kang magkapatid. Dalawa na magkapatid, the two Cayetanos, two Estradas. You have, meron ka rin mag-ina, Villar. And if Jojo Binay won, you would have father and daughter. But that didn't happen. But you have families in the Senate. How does this affect really the independence of the Senate, the quality of the debate in the Senate, and even the thinking that goes into deliberation when you have too many family members there?
I would rather leave that to those who are there. But it's on record. Number one, I am the only Drilon in the elected as an elected public official. Nobody else had presented himself or herself. No other relative has presented himself to the public. Second, and most important, I was among the first to file a bill to implement the anti-dynasty provision in the Constitution. I filed this not because of the relationship of dissenters found in the present Congress. I filed this several Congresses ago because I believe that there are advantages in having an anti-dynasty law without in any way passing judgment on the ability of relatives to perform their task as elected representatives of the people.
No. Okay. Now, minority is the next battleground. How important is it to form a strong minority in the Senate? And who do you believe should be Senate Minority Floor Leader?
First, the minority is very important in the Senate because it is an effective check and balance system. Even if there's only one opposition, because of the no crucial rule in the Senate, you can filibuster to block a bill. So you don't need that many. You just need somebody who is strong enough, competent enough to be able to debate and debate it forever if you want to block a piece of legislation. And this has happened in the past Senate's pattern.
So who do you believe should be the next Senate Minority Floor Leader?
Well, the only opposition candidate who won is
Senator Risa Ontiveros.
Risa Ontiveros. And therefore, by that circumstance, she should have a prior claim to the Senate opposition leader.
But I know that Senator, you know this as well, Senator Coco Pimentel is also gunning for that post.
Yes, Senator Coco Pimentel being a lawyer, having been a senator for quite a time, yes, he's qualified to take the cudgels for the minority. He has taken positions in the latter portion of his career in the Senate, opposite that of the administration, and he has shown his capability to be independent.
How many do you think, Senator Frank, just quickly, will be left in the minority? Because you have Senator Aimee Marcos saying that there should be a super majority in the Senate.
I don't know what that means, but anyway, you're saying how many more? No.
Yeah, how many are left?
So we're talking about two so far, Risa and Coco. But when the media carried the posting of the different senators, one thing I noticed is that Pia Cayetano, who is the present chair of our Committee on Ways and Means, a very important committee, talks about taxes, will be replaced by Win Gatsalian. This is a very significant development, because the majority of senators would have a first crack on the major committees, and especially in the case of Senator Pia, he's an incumbent chair of the Committee on Ways and Means. The fact that he lost that committee to Win Gatsalian is an indication to me that he wants to join the minority.
I just wanted to say quickly is we have finance, former finance secretary Cesar Purisima, who's watching, and he calls you his hero in the Senate with a syntax law, GOCC law, TIMTA law, banking liberalization. And you said, we were talking about it, that even if you were also an opposition senator in other administrations, is you've really focused and helped when it comes to economic laws.
That's right. Because, and you know, one of the fulfilling moments in my stint as minority leader was when I received just last month a letter from the economic team led by Secretary Sani Dominguez, central governor and incoming budget finance secretary Diokno, Carl Chua, acknowledging my help in passing the needed legislation to help our economy. And indeed, I am a firm believer that we should create employment, we should improve our economy through policies as enshrined in our laws that would be needed to make us more investment attractive, to make our tax production system more efficient, because 21/4 of our economy depends on government spending, and we really need to attract investors in our country.
All right. Now, Senator, just quickly, what kind of economy is President-elect Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. inheriting? What are the challenges that he has to face?
Yes, in general, the challenges he has to face is, number one, our health system, the weaknesses of the health system were exposed with the pandemic, with unfortunately the mismanagement of Health Secretary Duque. It has become worse, and that must be addressed. Second issue that must be addressed would be our education system. Very alarming, Karen. The World Bank report states that 9 out of every 10 Filipino children aged 10 does not know how to read. My goodness gracious, what will happen to our future generation? I repeat, 9 out of every 10 Filipino children aged 10 would not be able to read. This is very alarming. Of course, the third would be the economy, where you have a huge debt, very low revenue collection because of the pandemic, and the interest payments are getting more difficult because of the debt. And the fourth, of course, is the rule of law. That is a challenge. We must restore our people's confidence in the rule of law. You know, this mainly unsolved crimes is because of, to my mind, because of the perception that our justice system is not working. When people take the law into their own hands, it is an indictment of how they perceive our justice system to be. These are four areas to me that must be addressed.
All right, that's quite clear. What are your plans, Senator Drilon? After this, are you going to ride out into the sunset? Is it just pure retirement for you? Because actually, you could have run. You could have run for a local office. I asked you.
Yes, they asked. I was being asked to run for Congress. I thought I have served enough. Give others a chance. I will devote time to my family, who I have deprived. My grandchildren have grown up, and I have missed playing with them because of my work in government. So it's about time that I devote time for them. Well, of course, you never say what happens in the future, but if you ask me as I'm talking to you, the other desire that I have is to be a runner in the Senate, Karen, to get you the news that you may want to put across.
You said that before. You wanted to be the show's expert, remember?
Yes,
you said, I want to be, Karen, I want to be the Head Start analyst. The political, you said that.
I think I'm qualified.
Yeah. I would have to say more than other analysts, but that's on a light note. But moving forward, Vice President Leni Robredo, you know, the fate of the opposition, right? So she will be stepping down as chair of the Liberal Party. What do you suggest for Vice President Leni Robredo? Do you believe she should run for the Senate after 3 years?
I don't want to go far into that. I just want to say that I will fully support her in her desire to lead and to form a non-government organization, an NGO devoted to addressing the needs of the of those in the Laylayan, as she would say. Because, you know, the poverty in our country today is such that we need every hand on board. And I am glad that Vice President Leni has decided to continue with his her advocacy to provide a better future, a better life for those in the fringes of our society. And come July 1, I will volunteer if I am needed.
So you will still be active. I wanted to ask you. You'll be active in volunteering with Vice President Leni's NGO, but will you still somehow be active with the Liberal Party? What are your plans in that respect, even behind the scenes?
I don't intend to be active in politics. You know, I just want to help Vice President Leni in whatever area I can help. I believe in her cause, and but as I said, let's leave it at that. I cannot think. You know, I will devote time to my family, and that's it. Be an analyst for media.
Okay. Right now, what bill do you feel was very important that unfortunately did not make it?
Well, you know, the last one that frustrated me was the bill that would have required registration of SIM cards.
Yes.
And compelling the platform owners, operators, to require identification of the of those who would utilize their platform. Mm-hmm. You know, our basic to me, the trolls, existence of the trolls is so disgusting in our environment today. And you know, under the rubric of press freedom, everything is justified, including insulting, including false information. The bill that we proposed did not prevent you, or I'm sure did not prevent a troll from continuously availing of but it only required identity so that number one, the false information can be addressed
and be traced.
And the exercise of that freedom of speech carries with it responsibility. That is why we hold those of you, Karen, in media is held for libelous remarks. How can you hold responsible a troll whose identity is not made known? And that law would have required identification, or the requirement would have required the platform owners to reveal who are the who operates these trolls. You know, that issue without this bill, the lies and the false information will false news, fake news.
And are you optimistic that that would have the support of President-elect Bongbong Marcos?
Well, I can't make that judgment, but certainly the troll industry now is a very lucrative industry.
Okay.
And You know, just one more point.
Yeah.
The present administration, I am so disappointed. We suspect in the course of our examination of the budget that trolls are embedded in the budget of the present government.
All right. Well, on that note, I don't have enough time anymore. I don't want to go over time, but is there anything you want to add just very quickly?
Well, just let me thank our people for giving me this opportunity to be able to contribute my share in nation building. And let me thank the media for, you know, it has not always been a very smooth relation, but indeed, the media has stood as a guardian to enable us to continuously be able to debate on issues that confronted me in the Senate.
All right. Outgoing Senate Minority Leader Franklin Drilon, thank you very much, sir. You stay healthy. Good luck to you. And thank you for your service, sir.
Thank you, Karen. Thank you for having me again today.